as you walk around, you just see the way in which life comes back after a large catastrophic disturbance.
Do not mistake this volcanic landscape for a moonscape. Life has returned with a vengeance.
Under close inspection, if you walked around on these bare hill slopes, what you would find is a staggering number of species that are actually there, but all in very low numbers.
At Mount St. Helens, it's what happened after the eruption that exploded scientists' notions of ecological recovery. And it's revealed multiple mysteries. Why do giant fish grow unbelievably fast and then inexplicably die? How is it that amphibians absolutely flourish at a time when they're in trouble across the Cascades? And what are the ripple effects of the ancient logs floating over a fifth of Spirit Lake?
There is not a single theory or model that's adequately explained what we've seen at Mount St. Helens.
Nowhere do these complex tales of death and life coalesce as they do at Spirit Lake. It's Charley Crisafulli's living laboratory. Dozens of times each year, he treks miles to Spirit Lake to examine the water and its inhabitants. He's a Forest Service ecologist, and he spent his entire career studying Mount St. Helens ever since the eruption.
Well, I don't think anyone anticipated the pace, the rapid pace at which Spirit Lake responded.
Scientists wanted Spirit Lake left alone, and so it has remained.
We need to really think about what was here before.
Before the eruption seems hard to fathom anymore. A majestic old-growth forest of hemlocks and noble and silver firs covered every hillside. Camps and cabins dotted the lake's edge. May 18th, 1980, changed everything. The mountain exploded with a force of 10 megatons, as powerful as a nuclear weapon. 1,300 feet of the mountaintop rained down. It annihilated entire forests. The blast zone covered 250 square miles, and the largest landslide in recorded history headed straight for Spirit Lake.
Surged into the lake, pushed all of the water out of the lake, and when it did, it traveled about 800 feet up onto the adjacent hillsides and carried the forest, the soil, and all its inhabitants back down into the lake basin.
So much of the mountain landed here, the bottom of Spirit Lake rose 200 feet, and it spread out to twice its area.
So it's hard to believe that an entire lake can be physically moved, but indeed that's what happened here. Most life was obliterated.
After the eruption, water visibility measured in mere inches and felt as warm as body temperature. Within hours, bacteria multiplied, followed by months of new waves of bacteria and microbes. But within a few years, lake life had returned.
Well, more than just returned, I mean, by 1989, a mere 9 years after the eruption, the lake, in many respects, was typical of many other lakes in the Cascades, but it was never going back to its former self.
Today, Spirit Lake generates more nutrients than ever before. It has never been this productive. Life in Spirit Lake rebounded, except fish. The eruption had cut off the Toodle River. Then, one day in the early 90s, someone spotted a rainbow trout.
We're pretty certain that those fish were placed in here by someone. It was not a planned stocking by Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife.
Whoever planted the fish interfered with scientists' plans to watch the lake recover completely on its own. Fish then became part of the experiment.
This is something we do monthly from the time of ice out through late autumn when snow becomes a problem for access.
Every time Charley Crisafulli surveys the fish, he finds the same thing.
Oh, there's a tremendous number of fish.
Rainbow trout have multiplied. They thrive in Spirit Lake's now food-filled waters.
The fish are incredibly healthy. The population appears to be very robust.
With so many insects, the fish eat very well and have grown extremely large, remarkably fast. 3 times faster than normal.
It points to the fact that there's a tremendous food resource in the lake. Beyond that, we simply don't know.
The trout present a double mystery. First, they're giant. Many weigh 4 to 5 pounds.
They're quite young. These fish are only 3 and 4 years of age in attaining this size and weight.
Spirit Lake's fish at 4 years old are larger and longer than fish 3 times older elsewhere in the Cascades.
There it is.
The second puzzle.
Okay, incoming.
They're not nearly as old as they look. When Charley takes measurements, he also samples their scales. Scales reveal the fish's age.
Scales.
Every single trout is young. In fact, by 5 years old, they're dead.
Tag 05804. The oldest fish here has probably got 1 or 2 fish that is 5 years of age.
They should live 12 to 15 years. Their early and certain deaths remain a mystery. In Spirit Lake, water temperature readings are now back to normal.
And we'll drift right into the log now. I'm in neutral, I'm gonna kill the motor. There we go. Spirit Lake is the most well-documented lake in the Mount St. Helens blast area and may very well be the most thoroughly studied lake following a volcanic blast there is anywhere in the world. Can you get it?
As he works, Charlie's hanging onto a tree impaled in the lake bottom. It is just one of the tens of thousands of trees blasted off the hillsides. Most of them still float on the lake below.
Well, I think the wood is largely underappreciated, and clearly that's a place where we need to start focusing our attention in terms of research.
It is Spirit Lake's most famous feature. Floating logs bump and bang each other as far as the eye can see.
Take a look at this. It goes on for, you know, about 15 to 20% of the lake is covered with floating logs of the ancient forest that once surrounded the Spirit Lake Basin. And still here we are 27 years later and it's still afloat.
Hemlocks and true firs have sunk. Doug firs and cedar have not.
But I'm really surprised that they haven't become waterlogged and sunk to the bottom.
Wind blows the logs from one end of the lake to the other. They always seem to mass together. With such constant motion, the logs prevent something that used to happen every single year before the eruption. Ice. Spirit Lake does not freeze anymore.
So if you look across this expansive coverage of the lake, where light simply can't penetrate.
Sunlight ends up largely blocked wherever the logs happen to float.
Sunlight is very important for lake systems. It's so important to the very base of the food web, in this case, phytoplankton.
The logs do provide habitat.
Undoubtedly, the log mat is a large nursery for insects and fueling, you know, vigorous emergences.
But the logs are not just home to insects. They're fodder for new plants, even shrubs and trees that don't normally float.
Alder and willow trees actually growing out of the floating log mat. Young forest developing out in the log mat, which is truly bizarre.
And there's a new forest taking root on the hillsides around Spirit Lake. It's sparse, but for the first time since the eruption, trees are now producing seeds of their own. Cones are back.
And so now we're going to eventually see an apron of conifers downslope from this parent tree, and this is the initiation of the next forest to come within the Spirit Lake Basin.
Over a hill, and 1.5 miles from Spirit Lake, St. Charles Lake sits surrounded by trees flattened in the blast.
And in this basin, there was a great deal of survivorship, and that had to do with the timing of the eruption.
The eruption occurred in the morning, Nocturnal animals were safely back underground, and the cold of winter had not yet eased.
And on May 18, 1980, this lake was beneath several feet, perhaps as much as 6 feet of snow, and 3 or 4 feet of ice.
That snow and ice protected young trees, which have now grown to be the largest things on the landscape. And it provided a thermal buffer for life under the water.
Tens of thousands, perhaps hundreds of thousands, millions of individuals of most species survived somewhere in the blast area.
For amphibians, 15 species were known at Mount St. Helens before the blast. 12 survive to this day.
Excellent. Gorgeous specimen. Female.
It includes the Northwest salamander, which Crisafulli counts and measures each year.
The difference is all the animals we're sampling now in this lake are the aquatic form.
Many Northwest salamanders grow up, go through metamorphosis by losing their tails and gills, and then live on land. But for these, it's as if they know there's not yet a real forest nearby to live in. So they've adapted. They live out their entire lives in water.
Now almost this entire lake is suitable amphibian habitat.
It's one thing to account for amphibians surviving farther from the crater itself. But they are back at Spirit Lake too.
And what we've seen has been absolutely astonishing.
How does a creature as small as an amphibian even get to a lake that had been decimated of all life? Crisafulli believes they walked.
I've found them over 5 kilometers away from where we've marked them. So these animals get out and they move.
Charley found tree frogs on the move too, and a clue of how they survived the journey across the hostile pumice plain. They borrowed gopher holes to hide from the heat.
That's exactly right, and creates a stepping stone between suitable patches of habitats that are developing. And so any amphibian we find out here on the Pumice Plain and Spirit Lake had to come from some distant source population, so they had to disperse here.
Everywhere you look, the resurgence is remarkable. Frogs and toads were back at Spirit Lake within 1 year of the eruption. Salamanders reappeared within 5 years. Many of Spirit Lake's salamanders do go through metamorphosis, able to live on land. They then wander, doomed to search for a forest which does not yet exist. But with two strategies to stay alive, either in water or on land, the Northwestern salamander may have helped ensure its species' very survival in the face of overwhelming disturbance.
Essentially, they can switch hits. Some proportion of the population is in the water, some is on land, and as a consequence, they're able to spread the risk.
Some had predicted even surviving amphibians would not last, especially since amphibians are on such a decline in much of the Cascades.
And here we are 27 years later, and we've learned one thing for sure, is that the amphibians have done very well in the face of the 1980 eruption.
The succession of species, from bacteria to microbes, to plankton to plants, and amphibians and fish, has woven from Mount St. Helens a new web of life. And it has forced scientists to literally rewrite the books on what they thought they knew of ecology, natural catastrophe, and survival.
Mount St. Helens has provided a context or a backdrop for us to look at the way systems respond to disturbance better than any that we've had an opportunity to study before.